All right, welcome. I hope everybody's doing well today. We are talking about speciation, which is the process of how new species develop through evolutionary change. I have this lecture divided into two parts. In the first half, we're going to talk about what defines a species, so how do biologists define that concept? And then we'll talk about mechanism by which new species can develop. And then towards the very end, we'll talk a little bit about some things that can help reinforce the development of new species and several traits that could influence the rate at which species development might happen. All right, so we've all heard that term species before and probably at least have some general idea what that means. You know, we know different species are different organisms, but how do biologists actually define that? And so I should point out up front, there really is no easily agreed upon definition for species, even among biologists. This is something even today biologists will still argue about. So there are lots of different species concepts out there, and they're not all mutually exclusive, so there may be overlap between them. But really, these are all just different ways of getting at this question, you know, what defines a species? Okay. And so really the basic definition that I think most biologists would agree upon is you would say a species is a group of organisms that mate with one another, right? So biology is all about reproduction, and if we're thinking about speciation, it's all about evolution, right? Which again ties in with genetics and reproduction. So it's all about who's mating with who primarily. And, you know, traditionally a lot of species were just defined based on their appearance. So, you know, sometimes you can just look at two different organisms, they look different, and we say, oh, those are the same species or different species. So, for example, here we have two red-winged blackbirds, one from New York, one from British Columbia, right? So opposite ends of the North American continent, thousands of miles apart, and they basically look the same, right? We can look at it and say, yep, that's a red-winged blackbird. So Linnaeus, who we already talked about in a previous chapter for establishing that system of binomial nomenclature, he was really the proponent of this morphological species concept, meaning we're going to use appearance to define species. And, you know, sometimes that works really well, but there are some serious drawbacks to just using appearance. And I'll go back to the red-winged blackbird example here. So there are lots of examples where males and females of the same species may look radically different, especially in birds and sometimes in insects as well. So we already looked at our two male red-winged blackbirds from opposite ends of the North American continent. Well, here's a female red-winged blackbird, right? And so if you were just using just straight appearance to help define species, you would definitely not group this in with these two, even though they absolutely are, everybody would agree, the same species. So we really need to use some other types of information there. So as I said, there are lots of different species concepts being used, but probably the one that is most widely used, and that's why I'm going to focus on it here, is what's called the biological species concept, which has this somewhat wordy definition, but it's a group of populations whose members have the potential to interbreed in nature. So again, it all comes down to mating, but it's got to be in a natural situation. And that mating has to produce viable, fertile offspring. So viable meaning healthy, they can survive. Fertile meaning they're not a genetic dead end. And there has to be what we would call some reproductive isolation. So they do not breed successfully with other populations. Okay? So that's that isolation. So group of individuals who can interbreed in nature, produce these viable fertile offspring, and they don't breed with everybody, right? They can't breed with at least some other populations. So that would be our biological species concept. And, You know, if we're thinking of how new species can develop, again, this all goes back to evolutionary change. But I absolutely want to point out, not all evolutionary change is going to result in new species, right? So this is only going to happen occasionally. And if this all really comes down to mating, for speciation to happen, we really need evolution of that reproductive isolation. So that could be physical, right? Maybe these two populations physically can't interbreed for some reason, or it could even be a genetically determined behavioral trait, something like that, that prevents them from interbreeding. So let's look at how this could actually happen. How could we take one species and have it become reproductively isolated and split into two species? And if we think of this in terms of the genetics, so imagine this is our original population here, and we're just going to look at two genes in that original population, gene A and gene B. And we're going to say these two genes are controlling traits that are really important for reproduction, let's say, and mating. So, we have some genetic split in that original population, where you can see in this one branch now gene A has been mutated or changed in some way, right? We went from homozygous recessive to heterozygous. And then in this other population, gene B has been changed. So that would be the beginnings of this genetic difference that may be pushing these two populations towards reproductive isolation. And then, of course, over time, right, genomes are constantly changing and mutating. Maybe we further reinforce those differences. So we go from heterozygous at gene A to homozygous dominant, whereas originally we were homozygous recessive. And same thing's happening here at B. So now we're sort of reinforcing those differences. And if that continues over a long enough period of time, we may reach a point where these two populations now either can't or won't be able to interbreed with each other, and we might be able to consider them separate species at that point. Or, and another possibility is, maybe early in this process, these two populations do continue to interbreed with each other. They're hybridizing, we would say, with each other. That term is used to basically refer to two genetically distinct populations or even two different species interbreeding with each other. So if they hybridize, maybe we just kind of wash away any of these genetic changes that began, and we're back to just a single population. So we'd really have to maintain this separation and reinforce these genetic changes to get to that point where we really do have distinct species. And so I'm having you in discussion forum. Read an article about hybrids. And we tend to think about hybrids as something that would be man-made, right? Bred. But of course, hybrids can exist in nature. So as I just said, hybrids can result from two distinct species by that biological species concept, interbreeding and producing offspring with each other. So we got a few of the examples that were discussed in that article shown here. And I was just talking about genetic changes helping to drive speciation. And what researchers have found is that you really don't need a lot of genetic change in order to get reproductive isolation. So in this graph down here, we're looking at increasing reproductive isolation on the y-axis, and then increasing genetic change on the x-axis. And we see with just a little bit of genetic change, right, we move just a little way down the x-axis and things start to jump up really quickly on that y-axis. So we're getting lots of reproductive isolation with just a little bit of change. And I'll come back to this at the end of the chapter, but one really dramatic example of this is in some species of snails, and I don't know if you've ever really looked at a snail shell, but its shell kind of spirals out on one side or the other, either on the right side or the left side, spirals out. And it turns out if you have two snails that have spirals on opposite sides, so one with a right-handed spiral and one with a left-handed spiral, those two snails physically cannot mate with each other because parts do not line up correctly. And that direction of that spiral is determined by just one gene. So if you just mutate that one gene, right, a very small genetic change, all of a sudden you've got this complete, 100% reproductive isolation. So in a genetic sense, in an evolutionary sense, it may actually be pretty easy in a lot of instances to achieve reproductive isolation and start down that road towards speciation. So I want to talk about really these two well-studied and defined models for how speciation occurs, and they're called allopatric and sympatric speciation. I think allopatric is pretty straightforward and hopefully will make a fair amount of sense to you. Sympatric is a little bit more subtle, but hopefully we can get the main idea across here. So let's start by explaining what is allopatric speciation. And that word allopatric literally translates as other country. So this is speciation due to physical geographic separation. They don't literally have to be in other separate countries, but there has to be some significant physical barrier that's helping drive the speciation process. And this is by far thought to be the main mechanism of speciation in most cases. And so here's kind of a simple example illustrating that. So imagine you've got this situation here. We've got two mountain ranges and a valley in between with a river running through it. And you have this single species of plant, right, that grows across this whole region, so in the mountains and in the valley. And so now, over time, due to some geologic changes, the valley becomes completely flooded with ocean water, so long term, for an extended period of time. So obviously the plants that were living in the valley are gone, so we're just left with these two populations in the mountain ranges on either side, and they are physically separated from each other. So because this distance is far enough, there's no easy cross-pollination between those two groups, so they are essentially physically isolated from each other. And as they're physically isolated, right, each population is gradually accumulating mutations and some genetic changes over time, and just interbreeding with themselves. And so imagine then after some extended period of time, right, we have another geologic change where the ocean water recedes, and now the valley is exposed. And these two plant populations can regrow into the valley again and come into contact with each other, where they could easily exchange pollen. So if those genetic changes between those two populations have been great enough, we may have reached this point where now they are no longer able to reproduce with each other. They're reproductively isolated, and so we would consider them to be distinct species at that point, right? And it was really that physical separation combined with just, random genetic changes, mutation, evolutionary changes over time that drove that whole process. So that would be allopatric speciation. And we see allopatric speciation most dramatically illustrated in island chains, so archipelagos like the Hawaiian Islands or the Galapagos Islands. And the reason for that is because you have these island chains where the islands are close enough to each other that you can get occasional movement of organisms from one to another. Of course, it depends on what organism we're talking about. In this case, fruit flies, which are small, right, not built for long flights. So it would be difficult, if not almost impossible, for one of these fruit flies to be able to fly from one island to another. But occasionally, might get carried on a boat or some debris or blown in a storm or something like that. So it might happen occasionally. But the idea is you have these distinct islands. They may have distinct environments. If you've ever been to Hawaii, even on one particular Hawaiian island, you can have very different environments there, depending on whether you're at the coast or inland. But in this case, there are about 800 species of Drosophila in the Hawaiian Islands, and most of these are restricted to just a single island. And all the genetic studies that have been done seem to suggest that this probably was the result of about 45 different founder events, meaning, one of these flies or a small handful of these flies got somehow managed to make their way from one island to another, became geographically separated from their original population, and then over time, being driven by evolution in this new environment, right, became reproductively isolated and developed into a new species. So we have this happening over and over and over again until we go from these, 45 founder events to 800 species. It's a very dramatic example of allopatric speciation happening in a relatively short period of time. And that's very similar to what caught Darwin's attention in the Galapagos Islands. So he was looking at the tortoises and famously the finches, which we now call Darwin's finches. But the Galapagos are a very similar situation. And there are these 14 different species of finches that are all specialized for either different islands or, specific food sources on different parts of individual islands. And all the evidence now suggests that these 14 species probably developed from a single colonization event where one ancestral finch from mainland South America somehow ended up out in the Galapagos Islands. And again, geographic separation, allopatric speciation resulting in this explosion of new species. So there's a special term for this where you get a proliferation of this large number of species from the single ancestor as an evolutionary radiation. So we're radiating out these new species from the original. And if that radiation is due to specialization for different environments, we call it an adaptive radiation. So that radiation is adapted for these different environments, as we were just talking about, for example, on these different islands. So there's been lots of adaptive radiations in Hawaii and in the Galapagos. All right, I'm going to stop there and we will pick up and talk about sympatric speciation in the second half.